$70,000 a month, four, $70,000 a month. Last year, we supported a quarter of $70,000. It's crotch and really good for a quarter of
$70,000.
Not doing much. I'll tell you a secret. The more you say, the less I call.
To worship here at Bethesda Presbyterian Church. It is the third Sunday of Advent. Also would like to welcome our guest pastor this morning, the Reverend Donald Stewart. Don, thank you for being here. You can read more about his journey through life. He's had quite the adventure. He's done a lot of neat things through his life. Also like to welcome Jonathan McDuffie this morning. Thank you, Jonathan, for contributing to our music today. Also, we're continuing to the staff Christmas gift collection is underway, so if anybody would like to contribute to that, please have that in by the 17th. Choir rehearsal continues every Wednesday at 7 o'clock. And also, it's Sunday school classes continue at 10 o'clock. And Brenda Huffman continues to provide a light breakfast each morning, each Sunday at 9, starting at 9:15. Thank you.
Would you please stand for the morning call to worship? Let us use this time of worship to prepare the way for the coming of the Lord.
What must we do to be ready?
Repent of your sins and vow to follow the teachings of Jesus in all your ways.
We come before the Lord our God with repentant hearts and seek the power of the Holy Spirit to be faithful.
Would you remain standing and join together and sing hymn number 106, Prepare the Way, O Zion, 106.
Thank you.
may be seated. I'd like to invite the White family to come forward at this time for the lighting of the third Advent candle.
Watch and wait for Christ's coming. Light candles of hope, peace, joy, and love, remembering the promises of God with prayer. We light this candle in hope. We light this candle for peace. Light this candle with joy and joy. To those who live as exiles from dark time, to those enslaved as exiles due to others' oppressions, to those who are sins, exiles from their best God-promised selves, the Lord speaks in joy of good news. A reading from Zephaniah 3.
Sing aloud, O daughter Zion. Shout, O Israel. Rejoice and exult with all your heart, O daughter Jerusalem. The Lord has taken away the judgments against you. He has turned away your enemies. The King of Israel, the Lord, is in your midst, and you shall fear disaster no more. On that day it shall be said to Jerusalem, do not fear, O Zion. Do not let your hands grow weak. The Lord your God is in your midst, a warrior who gives victory. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will renew you in his love. He will exult over you with loud singing as on a day of festival.
I will remove disaster from you so that you will not bear reproach for it. I will deal with all your oppressors at that time, and I will save the lame and gather the outcast, and I will change their shame into praise and renown in all the earth. At that time, I will bring you home. At that time when I gather you, for I will make you renowned and praised among the peoples of the earth, when I restore your fortunes before your eyes, says the Lord.
Let us pray with scripture from Isaiah and Philippians. Bow your heads. Surely God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. For the Lord is my strength and my might. God has become my salvation. With joy you will draw water from the wells of salvation, and you will say in that day, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say, rejoice. Sing praises to the Lord, for God has done gloriously. Amen.
Thank you for that part of the worship service. The little ones, let them be little ones, okay? Let them be little ones while they can be little ones. Will you join together in the prayer of confession as found in the bulletin? Heavenly Father, as we hear again the words of John the Baptist, we realize anew how selfish we have been, how many opportunities we have missed. Love and concern. Also, our faith to share our abounding blessings with those in need.
Renew our
spirit within us. We pray that people will know your love through us.
Amen.
Oh, Holy Father, we thank you so much for the love you've given for us. To hear today in this season especially is to celebrate the coming of your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for your love of us and your love of your Son. He gave life for us so we might have life more abundantly. Bless all that we do in his name, Lord. And may his grace surround us in all that we're about. In your holy name we pray, Father. Amen. Do you stand and would you stand and greet each other in the peace of Christ?
Thank you.
Thank you. You may be seated. When it comes to the season of Christmas, the lectionary readings are not short. They're not brief. They are really long. So I'm sorry. That's the way it says we're supposed to do it. So we do it that way, okay? Before I go further, I'd like to just say who I am, tell you who I am, because I might never see you again. I want you to know me if you see me again, on a street corner somewhere. I'm a farm boy from Harnett County. I grew up picking cucumbers and priming tobacco. If you're from this area, you know what I'm talking about. If you're not from this area, you have no idea what I'm talking about. But my father was not a farmer, but my uncles were, and daddy ran an insurance business downtown Lewington. Upon graduating from high school, I farmed that summer, and that was one of the hottest years we ever had. It got 100 degrees a few different times. When I was out there in that biker field, following that tractor up and down that field, throwing back in them sleds, I thought to myself, there's got to be a better world than this. right as it was closing in and out on getting all the bike out of the fields and into the barns, I went what was then called Jonesboro, North Carolina. Now it's been incorporated into Sanford, North Carolina, and I joined the United States Navy. But, some things you really should talk to your parents about. I didn't. They were not real excited when I told them that evening that I'd be leaving in about 3 weeks. But that began a journey for me that was real different. We had kindergarten through 12th grade in one building, okay? It had two floors. But I knew about everybody in high school, and I drove a school bus 2 years in high school, so I knew a lot of elementary kids also, middle school kids. But when I went to the United States Navy, life changed for me. Basic training, it's worse than anything they ever tell you is. I mean, when they shaved my head, I knew I had no identity no more. I didn't know I had ears till I looked myself in the mirror that day and said, God, my ears grow three times the size they used to be. In the fifth week of basic training, they pulled us into a classroom and told us about different career options in the Navy. And I made another fatal mistake with that, talking to my parents, which I was not allowed to do at that time in my life in basic training. But a guy came in and said, who likes blowing things up? And I raised my hand. We blew up stumps and make new ground all the time at home, and I love to see stuff go up in there, put them in orbit. And he said, anybody like to hunt or shoot guns? I raised my hand again. I grew up rabbit hunting and dove hunting. And 3 weeks later, I was at Coronado Island going through SEAL training. And that was a real different life for me. Running along the beach with 60 friends is cool. But when you're carrying a light pole over your head, it's not cool. I survived that training and went on. I had 7 years in the Navy, did a pretty good job in the Navy. Into my third year of the Navy, I was involved with something that was pretty high class internationally wise, and received a presidential citation. And my handler said, you get to choose where you want to go for duty. He said, I've never done this for nobody before, so where do you want to go? And I was coming off the USS Guadalcanal, a ship with 5,000 men. I didn't think there's 5,000 men in Harnett County. And all on that ship together for 10-month cruise into the Indian Ocean. It got hot in Harnett County, but the Indian Ocean gets hotter. Off the coast of Iran, off the coast of Egypt, it gets real hot on a steel deck ship. But I told my handler I'd like to go to college, somewhere I could go to college. So he gave me three choices. I ended up choosing Naval Air Station Key West, Florida. So when my contract was up for that designated time period, I went down to Key West to finish up my contract. And the joke down there was, if Stewart's eyes hold out, he might graduate. Because St. Leo University had a program that every 6 weeks was a new semester. So on Monday and Wednesday night, I took a class from 4 o'clock to 6 o'clock. Then I took another class from 7 o'clock to 9:30. And then on Tuesdays and Thursdays, I did the same thing with two more classes. Then on Saturday morning, from 8 o'clock to 12:30, I took a class. And I went to work at 6 o'clock in the morning, got off work at 3:30, Monday through Friday. I graduated from college with honors on May the 23rd, and I got out of the Navy on June the 7th, so I cut it pretty tight. And upon getting out of the Navy, when my handler talked to me about where is my next duty station going to be, I, I offered some suggestions to them, and none of my suggestions were taken seriously. And I said, well, I'm just going to go home, I guess. He said, you can't go home. I said, excuse me? I'm stubborn. No. If you know anybody from Harnett County, I think everybody in Harnett County is stubborn, okay? I'll just be honest with you. And he said, well, we got a lot of money tied up, and you got to reenlist. I said, no, my contract's up. I obligated for 7 years. My 7 years is up. And he said, well, I'll talk to you in a little while. I said, whatever. And I went back to my office, and 15 minutes later, a young man that I'd done some work with in Special Ops from Naval Investigative Service. Pat came to the office. He knocked on the door. He said, hey, I hear you're not reenlisting. I said, no, I'm going to go home. He said, well, I'm here to offer you a job. I said, you are? I said, where at? He said, I don't even know who you're working for. I just got a call from Washington, D.C. I'm supposed to offer you a job. And you're supposed to say yes, and we're all going to be happy. And we talked for a few more minutes. I said yes. I ended up leaving Key West, and 4 days later, I reported to work down here in Fayetteville at what used to be called the Wachovia Building. It's called the Sistel Building, I think, now. On the third floor, I became a special agent with the Department of Defense, doing special investigations for the government. And I know your area well, because your area is one of the areas I work. Part of our responsibility was for anybody that had top secret clearance, we'd go out and run their backgrounds. And I've been all over these woods back here, back in them days, talking, because we had a lot of people in this community go into the military. And then we run periodic background investigations, and then when something would happen, it would be bad. We have to do those criminal investigations also. But I always wanted to go in the ministry. I've always been very close to the church, been very active in the church. And some of you who are a little bit older remember the name Ollie North. When all that events happened with Ollie North, my part of Department of Defense, we got weeded out, and we got sent to other agencies. And I went to the Department of Treasury as a special agent with the Treasury Department. And I did that until I had my 13 years in, gave me 20 years with the government. And at that time, I retired and went to med school at Duke, become a Methodist minister. And I served a church not too far from here, a little place called Ether, on the other side of Bisco. So you're going out through the woods out here. And began a journey as a pastor, and I graduated from Duke with a Master of Divinity degree, and spent 20 years in United Methodist Church. And, my father got very ill with Alzheimer's, and I told my wife, I said, they don't want to go to a nursing home. I told him I would not. I'd do my best to keep him from having to be put in a nursing home. So I retired from the Methodist Church and came home and took care of him and took a job at the prison in Sanford. I was in the Methodist Church. I'm not sure how it is in the Presbyterian Church, but the Methodist Church, you can pay all you want to in your retirement, but you can't touch it till you turn age 62. So I had to work for a number of years at the prison at Sanford. So when I turned 62, I retired from there and with time in service, and I bought back my time from military time with them. And they kind of began this journey I'm on with y'all now. I told my wife when we came home, when we retired, I said, I'll follow you anywhere you want to go. You've been following me for the last 15 years. I'll follow you for a little while. And she said, well, let's go to this little church down the road here. She was raised Baptist. I figured we'd be going to Antioch Baptist in Mainers. We ended up going to Leaflet Presbyterian Church right below our house, about a mile. Pat Fletcher was our pastor at the time. And I'd been there about 6 months or so. She came down with cancer. And she asked me, said, would you cover my pulpit on the Sundays after I have chemo on Thursdays? I said, I will. Be glad to. And so for about 6 months, I did that with her. And she introduced me to Laura Lupton, who y'all in the leadership roles know Laura Lupton. And then she introduced me to the Committee on Ministry of the Coastal Carolina Presbyterian. And I met with them over at Page Memorial Church in Aberdeen. Where am I at? That way, I guess. And about 3 hours while they talked about, was I good enough to be serving the Presbyterian Church as a pastor? And they approved of that. So I've been doing this now for a number of years. I'm somewhere different every Sunday. So thank you for the opportunity of being here with you. During my fourth year of ministry at Ether, United Methodist Church, I met a young lady who was a young widow with two little girls. And I did something I would not highly advise people to do without a lot of thinking. I did do a lot of thinking, and I still wouldn't advise it to do without somebody else doing a lot of thinking. But I married three women instead of one woman. Because when you marry a young widow with two little girls, you marry all three of them. You don't just marry the mama. And So now Stephanie is 34, Nicole is 30, and we've had one child of our own, a little girl named Jennifer, who's just turned 22. And we have two granddaughters who are pretty special, I think, as most grandparents think so, that are 7 years old. And our middle daughter is going to be getting married sometime the next year. She just got engaged last weekend, and her and I don't know what it is about women. Women love weddings, okay? They're okay, but you know, y'all get excited about stuff a year away, maybe a year out of the out. But my little, one of the twins, my wife, my oldest daughter, the oldest daughter is one with twins. She was talking with her yesterday about the wedding and so forth. And Emlyn is 7 years old, about that tall. Walks like this. And her little sister's just a shrimp. And she's you would a lot smaller. But Emma said, I tell you one thing, Mama. Annalise can wear a dress, but I'm not wearing a dress. I'm going to wear a pantsuit. And my wife said that caused a brief discussion real fast about that. So we're looking forward to seeing what happens with that in the year to come. But that's who I am. I do this because I like preaching. I like going out and meeting different people. And this is a special Sunday. As Julie said, a lot of things have changed this morning, so I've got to fill some time up. I won't plan on doing a lot of things we're doing this morning. But bear with the scripture this morning. They're strong scriptures. They're important scriptures for us to hear. The first one is going to come from Matthew, the 4th chapter, the 12th verse through 17, if you'd like to follow along with me. Hear the words of the Lord. Now when he heard that John had been taken into custody, he withdrew into Galilee. And leaving Nazareth, he came and settled in Capernaum, which is by the sea, all the region in the region of Zebulun and Naphtali. This was fulfilled what had spoken through Isaiah, the prophet, saying, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea, beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who were sitting in the darkness saw a great light. And to those who were sitting in the land and shadow of death, upon them a light dawned. From that time, Jesus began to preach and say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. This is the word of the Lord for the people of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll have special music at this time.
On a night so long ago, by the light of one bright star, two weary travelers far from Galilee took a refuge in a stable where a little child was born to bring the gift of love to you and me. When the angels told the shepherds of his birth, and there came a great rejoicing on the earth, and they sang, glory to God in the highest, dawning that first Christmas morn. Peace on earth and tidings of great joy, for unto you this night a child is born. And lo, these many years since then, that ancient star still guides us, and now again our Christmas voices ring. Blessed we are and safe at home, with loved ones here beside us, and in the still and silent night they sing. place of his birth. And there came a great rejoicing on the
Thank you very much. Thank you. The second reading is from the Gospel of Luke, and it's a long reading. It's from the Gospel of Luke, the third chapter, verses 1 through 20. Hear the word of the Lord. Now in the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, when Pilate was governor of Judea, and Herod was a tetrarch of Galilee, and his brother Philip was a tetrarch in the region of Tula and Tekoa, and Lysias and Thecla of Abban, and the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, the son of Zacharias, in the wilderness. And he came to all the district around the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make ready the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every raven shall be filled up, and every mountain and hill shall be brought low, and the crooked shall become straight, and the rough road smooth, and all the flesh shall see the salvation of God. He therefore began saying to the multitudes who were going out to be baptized by him, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Therefore bring forth fruits in keeping with repentance, and do not begin to say yourselves, we have Abraham for our father. For I say to you that God is able from the stones to raise up the children of Abraham. And also the axe is already laid at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. And the multitude questioned him, saying, then what shall we do? And he would answer and say to them, let the man who has two tunics share with him who has none, and let him who has food do likewise. And some tax gatherers also came to be baptized. And they said to him, teacher, what shall we do? And he said to them, collect no more than what you have been ordered to. And some soldiers were questioning him, saying, and what about us? What shall we do? And he said to them, do not take money from anyone by force or accuse anyone falsely, and be content with your wages. Now while the people were in a state of expectation and all were warning in their hearts about John, as to whether he might be the Christ, John answered and said to them, as for me, I baptize you with water, but one is coming who is mightier than I. I am not fit to untie the thong of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire, and his winnowing fork in his hands to thoroughly clear the threshing floor and gather wheat into his barn. But he will burn up the chaff with the quenchable fire. So with many other exhortations also he preached the gospel to the people. And when Herod the tetrarch was approved by him on account of Herodias, his brother's wife, and on account of all the wicked things which Herod had done, he added this also to them all. And he looked upon John and put John in prison. May God bless the reading and the hearing of his word. Word of God for the people, God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. O Holy Father, we are indeed in a time of worship now. We have gathered together as your people, those who call you Father, who you call your children. We thank you for the choir and the beautiful music we've heard already this morning, for the special music that was just presented. And Lord, we pray now that as the service continues, you'll be with the words proclaimed, and with the blessing of the elements, we receive Holy Communion later in the service. May indeed your Spirit be upon us and your grace be with us. In your holy name we pray, Father. Amen. I'm 65 years old, so that dates me a little bit, okay? But when I was in the Navy, and my younger sister made me a little zip-up hoodie sweater, like coat, and I like Snoopy. See, she embroidered Snoopy on the back of it. And now my grandchildren wear that same little hoodie. They take turns wearing it. And my wife said, how long are you going to keep that thing? I said, as long as anybody wants to wear it, I'm going to keep it. That's part of me they get to share in. And see, that's kind of what happens in this scripture this morning. We read these scriptures because they're us. We get to share in them. I like Charlie Brown a whole lot. It's a classic cartoon. Charlie Brown says to Lucy, someone has said that we should live each day as if it were the last day of our life. Oh, cries Lucy, this is the last day of my life. This is it. She dashes away screaming in her drama way. I only have 24 hours left to live. Help me, help me. This is my last day. Ah, Charlie Brown says this is the last day. Living each day as if it were the last day of our life is not a bad philosophy. Living each day as if it were the first day of our life might be a better one. This is the new year with exciting new possibilities. The old year is gone. The mistakes we made, the obstacles we have overcome are now past. As we look at a new year ahead of us, what will we do? So I worked this week and past 2 weeks in this sermon. I reminded myself of something that happened at Duke back in 92. I had not been there long, just started school there. At that time, Duke basketball really was not good. Coach K was there, and the later years was beginning. The Hurley years was all fixed to begin. And again, I do things because I feel like I need to do things at times. And while at Ether, serving that little church, had a little 7-year-old kid who came down with cancer. Her name was Carrie. And I'd go visit her each day there at Duke Children's Hospital there at Cyril's Children's Center. I'd check in on her, say how she's doing. And her and all those other little children there are tough shape, okay? They really are in the children's hospitals. The children are in tough shape there. And it was a long walk from the campus to the hospital there. It's a longer walk back to my car because I had to go across campus, get back to RT parking lot. And this one day, it was right this time of the year, getting close to Christmas. School was almost out for the Christmas break. I always would ask Carrie, I said, anything you'd like for me to do for you, honey, or anything you need from home or anything? She looked at me and she said, Donald, you probably can't do it, but I would like for you to do something for me. I said, try me out, honey. I've done a lot of odd things in my life. She said, I want a picture of the Duke basketball team. I said, you want what? She said, I want a picture of the Duke basketball team. I said, well, we'll see what we can do. Well, that afternoon when I left the children's hospital to go back to my truck in RT parking lot, Cameron Indoor Stadium is about halfway between the two places. And again, Duke weren't good then, okay? They were starting to get good, but they weren't not good. They still had the old offices in there and had no security whatsoever. So here I come as a first-year graduate student. I'm walking in Cameron Indoor Stadium, and I look around. I walk in, and there is nobody there. I walked into the basketball court. I figured I'd find somebody shooting basketball there. There was nobody there. I saw this door was open, the double door. I walked in and said, is anybody in this place? And around the corner came Coach K. And he said, what do you want? How'd you get in here? Why you bother me? I said, excuse me. I said, I'm here because a young girl that's dying, possibly dying in the children's hospital, asked me for the picture of the Duke basketball team, and I'm her pastor. I'm a student here in the Divinity School, and I thought I might find somebody who could point me in a direction and get in a picture for her so she'd have a nice Christmas this year. He said, wait a minute. He turned around, walked back out of the office, came back through the double doors that he came in through. He said, hey, how you doing? Can I help you? I said, yes, sir. I said, he said, well, we can do something about that. He said, forgive my attitude. He said, I'm not from this area, and I got a rough attitude, and I got to change that. I said, I'll be honest with you, Coach K. You go spend some time in the children's hospital, your attitude will change. I said, can I get something for my little girl? He said, she's your child. I said, no, but she's one of my children of the church I serve. I said, I have a little several little church out here, right smack in the middle of North Carolina. And I said, this is what she wants for Christmas. I said, she didn't ask to live. She asked for a picture of a Duke basketball team. He said, she'll have it before night. I said, thank you. And I walked out of the office, went on the RT parking lot, got my little truck, and started my little 2.5-hour trip back to Ether, North Carolina from Durham. And much to my dismay, that was a John the Baptist moment. That was a John the Baptist moment. Those who proclaim, he is coming, he is coming. And I will say till the day I die, that's the most closeness I've ever felt to God 24 hours later when I stepped back into that children's center the next day when I came back to school. Coach K kept his word, but Coach K started a ministry that afternoon. All his players were required to spend some time at the children's hospital, at least 1 hour a week, to go there and just visit with them. They didn't have to have prayer with them, nothing like that, but they had to go there. They had to experience those children in their lowest points, because some of these guys are going to be superstars. Some of them are going to be multimillionaires. He wanted them students to learn what it was like to see someone who didn't have nothing but hope to live another day. Now, that was in 1996. To this very day, not only does the Duke basketball team go there, but members of the football team go there, members of the baseball team go there, members of the tennis team, men and women sports go. Now, the athletic department has adopted that as their special outing. They don't call it a ministry, they call it a special outing for the athletes. They touch those kids that are really sick, touch those parents that are there hoping the child will be able to come home. But see, John the Baptist says, prepare the way, for the Lord is coming. Prepare the way. The sermon this morning, as we first go into Holy Communion, I get long-winded real easy. The sermon this morning is, what was seen at Bethlehem? Yes, the baby born in Bethlehem was seen. But look at all the things that went along with that event. Look at the wise men. Look at the shepherds. In my household, I had to go out and buy a new nativity scene because one of our animals got broken last year. And one of my granddaughters said, we can't have a nativity scene next year without a cow. You can't just go buy a cow. You got to buy the whole outfit, the whole set. So we got a new nativity scene at our house. But what was seen at Bethlehem was more than just a birth of a child. It was a birth of a life that changed lives and gave you and I that same opportunity to change lives. In your life, who has touched you in ministry? And in your life, who have you helped find ministry in their life? Because we all need Christ at different times, especially during this past year when we've gone through this pandemic that we've gone through. Where do you find Christ at? I find Christ helping people, offering kind words, sometimes a simple smile. I hate these masks because you can't see anybody smile no more. But we can't really shake hands no more. I'm a hugger. I haven't been able to really embrace in congregational love in 18 months basically now. We're afraid to do that. And I understand that, okay? But where do you find yourself at related to that baby? Where do you find yourself at related to Mary, the mother of that baby? And where do you find yourself at, Joseph, who followed the word of the Lord and took his wife and went there and was told there was no room in the inn? But I have a stable available. So he took the stable for his wife who was fixing to give birth to a child. What do you say to the wise men who came afar and have been following that star for a long, long time? And what do you say to those who heard the angels out of the hillside? And see, each one of us is somewhere in there, okay? It didn't happen 2,000 years ago. It happens today, every day. Here in about 2 weeks, we're going to celebrate it in a big time way with the birth of Christ being remembered again. Then we'll be lighting all 5 candles. But I ask you and make a plea to you. You'll probably never see me again. You may not. But if you don't ever see me again, take this away today. For in a few moments, we're going to break bread. We're going to break bread. And when we break bread, we say to Jesus, Lord, I am a sinner. Lord, I have messed things up bad at times. But Lord, please forgive me. Please offer me your grace. And sometimes we say, Lord, thank you for letting me nail it right today. I did it right. Thank you for letting me touch so-and-so's life in a very special way. Thank you for putting me where you put me at today. But see, when we break bread today, we come humbly, beseeching God to say, here I am, Lord. Here I am. Use me as you can. This is Christmas season. This is a gift of love that Christ offers to us through the sacrament of Holy Communion. Where are you going to find yourself at in 2 weeks? I'm going to tell you right now, I'm serious on this. If you got shut ins that are in facilities or homebound, next 2 weeks you need to watch over them real carefully. From 20 years of ministry, a lot of the elderly shut-ins will die the week between Christmas Day and New Year's Day because they want to be there with their family that last time. They want to see the children be happy. Because, see, if you're 90 years old, when you were a young person growing up, family was it. Y'all went to the same school. Y'all pretty much lived in the same community. And town was a once a week, maybe once a month thing you did. It was not like it is now. My youngest daughter is 22. She ain't got a clue what's going on in her life, okay? She's got a good job. She works hard. But now everything's busy. I told my wife last night, okay, what man in here is married? Raise your hand. If you're married, raise your hand. I want to ask you a serious question. Did your wife ever get mad at you about stuff? I told her last night, I said, I wish the cell phone had never been invented. She said, why? I said, for 2 hours, all you've done is that thumb thing. I said, that's all you've done. I said, I'm talking to you, you tell me to be quiet, you're busy. I said, we're in a car traveling 55 miles an hour. I said, I wish they'd never invented them. I said, the world would be a better place in many ways. And I do believe that. And I won't tell you what she told me. I am in the pulpit. I am in the pulpit. But do something for somebody today. That's my challenge for you today. We're going to celebrate Holy Communion. We're fixing to move to that time of worship. And as you receive Holy Communion, as you walk out of the church this morning, you're going as an ambassador for Christ. That's what Holy Communion is about. We accept God's love.
We accept God's grace and God's power and God's majesty. Go forward and share that majesty, share that power in a loving way. Offer Christ in some simple way to somebody before the sun sets today, okay? Let us pray. Oh, Holy Father, Bethlehem was so important to us. It was a changing event that has changed lives for over 2,000 years, continues to change lives. And Lord, and this morning as we move into a time of having Holy Communion, may your blessings be upon us there. And may you know our needs, because you know everything about us from the very beginning of time to the very end of our time. And Lord, may we serve you and be gracious to you, as you indeed have served us and are gracious to us. In your holy name we pray, Father. Amen.
I told Julie a little bit earlier, I've never wore one of these things, so if it don't do right. I'm sorry, I got ahead of myself. Let us stand and join together in hymn 403. Open now the gates of beauty. Be seated. At this time, we will gather here now for the morning's Holy Communion service, the Lord's Supper. Those gathered here, tables will be open for you to come upon direction. Let us hear. The breaking of the bread. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it and gave the disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup. In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is new covenant, sealed in my blood. Shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Every time you eat this bread or drink from this cup, you proclaim the saving death of the risen Lord until he has come. Let us receive the elements at this time. Gracious God, may we who have received this sacrament live in the unity of your Holy Spirit, that we may show forth your gifts to all the world. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Will you join together in affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed? Would you please stand? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, only His Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. Ascended to heaven. Third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sit at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And this he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of life, life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Let us have a prayer for our offering this morning. Oh God, we present these offerings as one way we have of showing our concern for the needs of others. Bless them, we pray, and through your church, use them to help meet the needs of your children throughout the world. Amen. Let us receive our offerings at this time. The ushers, please come forward. Would you join together in singing? Was that verse one we just sang, right?
Yeah. That's what we sang.
Okay.
Let's pray. Yeah.
Let's pray. Holy God, as we prepare to celebrate the birth of the Holy Child of Bethlehem, we gather to give you thanks for the gift of your Son, Jesus, whose coming into the world has drawn us nearer to you. Bless this service, we pray, that we may go out from it determined to do our part in building your kingdom. Amen. Will you join together in the Lord's Prayer? Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Would you turn to page 132 for a closing hymn, Good Christian Friends Rejoice, and number 132.
Thank you.
our benediction. We came this morning to worship, to be with friends and fellow Christians, take part in the holy service today. And Lord, we have been at worship today. We've heard the words sung. We've taken part in Holy Communion. We've heard the word proclaimed. And we've read your scriptures. Go forward now in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.